Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're out the range with some Beretta handguns. The Beretta handguns that I've brought out are a number of different M9 service pistols. The handgun that I have here in my hand is an original M9 military service pistol. As a matter of fact, this is something of a rare bird. This handgun was sold by Beretta probably close to a decade ago now as a special edition. There's only a limited number of them produced, and they have all the same markings as an original military M9. It was sold in a box that had a holster and a belt in it with a certificate of authenticity, and they've become something of collector's items. However, what's really notable about the handgun is if you take a close look at it, you'll see a lot of really cool marks on it, like the PM mark here, the C cartouche on the hammer, and stuff like that. I've been shooting the M9 Beretta for many years. I've shot the first one probably around 1988 or 1989, which was the first time I had actually purchased one for my own use. And the military adopted the handgun about the same time, around 1985. In 1985, the US Army decided it was time to take a step away from the very popular 1911 handgun and replace it with something more modern. At the time, the 1911 hadn't been manufactured since World War II, so those guns were getting a little bit long in the tooth, were starting to reach the end of their service lives, and so the US government had to make a decision. Do we put the old 1911 single-stack 45 ACP back into production, or do we adopt a 9mm caliber, follow our NATO allies, and pick up a new handgun? The M9 was the handgun that was adopted. Now, this handgun has gone through a number of different evolutions over the years, some subtle changes and also some not so subtle changes. There's an M9A1, and now there's a brand new handgun called the M9A3. The A3 came about because the US government, some 30 years later, is now thinking about switching horses and jumping over to a totally new handgun and abandoning the M9 in its entirety. And that's what I want to talk about this afternoon, the M9 service pistol and some of its different variants. Let's do a little bit of shooting with the original version here. Very smooth shooting handgun. Let's take a look at some of the other variants. Laying here in front of me, I have the original M9, and then right above it, I have the M9A1. The changes made to the A1 were made at the request of the United States Marine Corps, and this is a pistol that they have adopted in limited numbers. The US military, regarding the Army, Navy, other branches, still use the original M9, and the M9A1 has trickled out into various branches, but again, primarily it's in use by the Marines. So some of the changes that happened between the original M9 and then the A1, let's just talk about some of the bigger, more notable changes. First of all, if you look at the dust cover, which is this area right here of the original M9, it's just smoothed with a radius to it. All right, if you take a look at the M9A1, it now has a Picatinny rail, although with only one T-slot right here, so you can mount lights to it and other things. You'll also notice on the M9A1, the front of the trigger guard is squared off. That's so a light will butt up against it, and your switches will be right here. On the original M9, it has an offhand shooting notch for you to wrap that support hand finger around it to get a hold of the pistol, which was really popular in the 80s. It's not so much popular anymore. Some other changes, if you take a look at the grip contours. All right, let's see if I can hold these up so you can see them both. The M9's in the front and the M9A1 is in the back. You'll notice the contour is slightly different, but if you take a look at the checkering on the back strap, you'll notice that the original M9 is just a series of straight lines cut into the receiver, and the A1 has a checkering pattern. The same is true for the front straps as well. The M9A1 has a plastic trigger in it. It also has, I should say polymer, it's probably more descriptively accurate, and a polymer guide rod. All right, so plastic trigger, polymer guide rod, probably used to reduce cost. On the original M9, the trigger is metal, and the guide rod is also made of metal. Some of the complaints of the handgun by US military personnel would include the fact that the handgun is rather large, has a large grip, it has a hump here on the rear, long reach to the trigger. A guy like myself with big old Yeti hands, this isn't so much of a problem, but you find a smaller statured person that might have to use this pistol, and you're gonna run into some problems. The gun isn't gonna fit their hand properly, and it's gonna make marksmanship rather poor. You'll also notice something that I'll point out in these two handguns, And then when we talk about the M9A3, one of the things that has changed there is the front sight on both the M9 and the M9A1 is machined into the slide. It's not dovetailed, meaning you cannot replace it. The rear sight is dovetailed, so you can replace it. You'll also notice, I don't know if you'll be able to see this, but if you look at the rear sights, you have a two-dot rear sight on the M9A1 and a half-moon single dot underneath the notch on the original M9. That's another one of the changes between the two pistols. So now that the military's looking to replace the M9 potentially, Beretta has submitted a handgun, which is the M9A3, to compete in the trials. Originally, when the U.S. military, in particular the Army, was talking about possibly switching handguns, Beretta preemptively submitted the M9A3, hoping that the U.S. Army would accept it because it meets most of their stated requirements for a new handgun and would simply not open up the trials, which, in my opinion, would make financial sense. Why the U.S. Army deciding now, 15 years after we've been at war and pretty much winding our war effort down overseas, now why they want to adopt a handgun when they, or if they're going to do it, they should have probably adopted it before the war. Now that they're doing it, just doesn't make sense to me. Also, they're pretending like the M9 is not a serviceable handgun. The handgun works quite well. Is it the best handgun on the market? That's up for debate. But is it a serviceable military handgun? It most certainly is. So Beretta was hoping to appeal to their sensibilities and reason, but as typical with Uncle Sam, they'll have none of that. So they've spun up military contracts to waste millions of our tax dollars looking for a new handgun that we don't need, which is typically issued to rear echelon troops. It's not a primary fighting weapon, okay? Officers like to carry them, machine gun crews will carry them, things like that, but most of the fighting done in the military is done with rifles. Okay, off that soapbox. This is the new M9A3. Probably the most noticeable difference would be the fact that it looks like a scar in its color scheme. It's flat dark earth, or various shades thereof. The M9A1 next to it, you can see there are some notable differences. Now, one thing that I'd like to point out is that this handgun has almost 100% parts compatibility with the existing handguns already in inventory of the major components. By major components, I mean things like the barrel, the slide, the recoil guide spring, the spring itself, stuff like that. Some of the changes that have taken place are the reduction of the grip, thinner grip panels, which makes the handgun smaller and easier to get a hold of, but even with my large hands, it feels really good. But it also has another grip panel that you can put on here, which would give you the humpback if you have larger hands like mine and you want to make the handgun more ergonomic for those larger handed shooters. One of the other changes that the Marine Corps requested because of experiences in the Middle East and the sand, notice these magazines. These magazines have a strange hue to them. It's called a PVD coating. It's a self-lubricating coating which is designed to move smoothly over things like sand. The original magazine, which I have here in my original M9, is just black. It's a standard metal magazine with just a traditional coating or finish applied to it. And what some of the soldiers are reporting is when they get covered in sand, it became very hard to get the magazine into the gun or get the magazine out of the gun. And it would also cause malfunctions if sand got into the magazine. So this coating is applied inside and out of the magazine, thusly improving the reliability of the handgun substantially in adverse conditions. So the M9A3 has that PVD coated magazine. The Marines, for whatever reason, decided to go with a 15-rounder. The M9A3 uses a 17-round magazine. All right, so even the original M9 used 15-round magazines. So the fact they've been able to squeeze two extra rounds in there is a nice touch. So let's go ahead and strip this gun down really quick, and I'll show you just how similar it is to the original M9. All right, so I just hit the takedown lever, slide and frame come apart just like you would expect. Take your recoil spring and guide rod out. Push a little button on the rear of the barrel locking mechanism, and it will just slide right out of the gun. You'll notice that this barrel is 5.1 inches in length. Let's take apart the M9A1. It has a 4.9 inch barrel. That's because the A3 has a threaded barrel, allowing the use of a suppressor. All right, so here's the M9A1 barrel. Here's the M9A3 barrel. You'll see it's slightly longer. Now what I'm going to do is take the M9A1 components and put them into the M9A3, including the guide rod and spring. And for giggles, I'll go ahead and put the M9A1 frame on the A3 slide. Parts commonality, right? Money saver. Makes perfect sense, and actually doesn't look half bad. Kind of like the way that looks. All right, so let's take it back apart and put it back the way it should be. As you can see, the M9 is a very simple pistol to strip and maintain. And it's a very elegant pistol. And by that I mean, it's a good looking handgun. It looks like an Italian handgun, even though it's made here in the United States by Americans. It's graceful, it's very smooth because of its locking mechanism, which is borrowed directly from the Walther P38 pistol. It has a dropping block, but as you see when the slide moves rearward, the barrel moves straight back, doesn't drop like a Browning action. It gives it a lower recoil impulse. The handgun also sets low in your hand compared to competitors like the SIG P226. So it's just a big, smooth shooting handgun, a very comfortable handgun to shoot, especially now that the M9A3 has this reduced grip, thinner grip panels, and material taken off here in the rear. All right, that's enough talking about this handgun. Let's actually do some shooting with the new M9A3. This holster is made by G-Code. It's actually been adopted by the US military in the past. This one is made for the M9A1 with its Picatinny rail. And as you can see, the A3 fits nicely in the existing holster. The belt that I'm wearing is an HSGI belt, and these are HSGI tacos, which are really handy little devices. I have some pistol mags here and some AR-15 magazines here. This is what's typically called a war belt. All right, let's do a little bit of shooting with the M9A3 and see how it shoots. Another improvement to the A3 is the inclusion of the D-series mainspring, which yields a much lighter double-action pull over the standard M9, but it also makes for a much nicer single-action pull. The magazine release has been changed out to an extended version that's squared and checkered, which makes it easier to hit the magazine release button, making sure that your magazine will come out quickly and easily. All right, the handgun shoots really good. Another one of the things that they addressed with the new A3 version is if you take a look at the decocker lever here, you can see it on both sides of the pistol. You can see it has a 15 degree upward angle. The standard M9 and M9A1, this lever looks more like this. It's more straight. The reason they've cocked it at an upward angle is because when troops were doing slide manipulations, should they have a malfunction, when they would grab the handgun, they could inadvertently engage the safety and disable the trigger on the handgun. With that upward 15 degree rake, if you grab the slide and pull rearward, you're actually pushing up on the safety lever versus pushing it down, so you can quickly grab the slide and do manipulations, and you're more inclined to actually engage the safety in terms of putting it in the fire position versus putting it on safe. Another thing that Beretta has done to alleviate that, this is what's called the FS model, meaning that when the weapon's cocked, you activate the safety, it drops the hammer and deactivates the trigger. There's another option. It's called the G version. The G version, this lever simply acts as a decocker. So when you hit the decocker, a spring will push it back to the fire position, and the trigger is never disabled. It's just strictly a double action pistol, except when it fires, of course, then it cycles and becomes a single action. Hit the decocker, you release it, it pops back to the fire position automatically, and that first shot is double action. The nice thing is if you buy the FS model like I have here, you can purchase in the future the parts to change the gun over between an FS model and a G model where it's either just decock or decock and safe. The A3 is a real sweet shooting pistol. If you've ever shot a Beretta before, and you're kind of accustomed to the M9, you're definitely going to want to pick one of these up and give it a feel. The grip angle is completely different. It feels more like a 1911. It sets more upright in your hand versus having the hump here pushing it forward, although the gun does come with the hoe grip in the package where you'll have that hump back here, and it gives it a more softer, rubbery feel, but it also thickens the grip and makes it feel more like an original M9. I actually kind of like this new slimline grip. It really, really shoots nice for me. The gun's got a really positive feel to it with the serrations. It locks firmly in your hands. It does actually make a difference over the original M9 serrations, which again were just those straight lines in the back. It has a very solid feel to it. Let's go ahead and make sure that we got a round in the chamber here, which we do. The gun actually does have a loaded chamber indicator on it, just a slight red line. But what I've noticed with these guns in the past is that once the gun gets dirty, carbon builds up and you won't necessarily be able to see that little red dot. So you'll find yourself doing press checks to see if you have brass in it. But look how I'm doing that press check. First of all, I have a nice serration right here. It's a nice scalloped out area in the front of the slide. I can pinch it without putting my hand in front of the muzzle, pull it to the rear slightly, and because of its open top design, I can clearly see and feel that there's a round in the chamber. The gun also has very nice sights. Might as well talk about that here really quick as well. It has tritium inserts here in the rear. The sights are very tall and they're squared on the front, which means you can use them for slide manipulations if you have to. And also the front sight now is dovetailed and also has a large white dot with a tritium insert in it. So overall, it's got better sights than the original two M9 and M9A1 pistols. All right, the gun's empty. Now what I'm going to do is show you another feature of the A3, and that is the threaded barrel. Unscrew the thread protector. Take out your Griffin Armament Revolution 9 suppressor, which is in the K configuration. One of the cool features about the Griffin Armament cans, and the reason I like them so much, especially the Rev 9, is the fact that I can take two baffles out of this can and shorten the overall length, making a very short, handy little suppressor for a handgun. And with subsonic ammunition, it's so quiet, I don't need my hearing protection. What I'm shooting right now is 147 grain Hush ammunition from Freedom Munitions. Really good ammo and nice and quiet out of this pistol. I won't shoot steel because I know you guys complain about it when I do. I'm just going to shoot some paper out there. How cool is that? I've always wanted to suppress one of my Berettas, but it's always been kind of a challenge finding a good threaded barrel for it. Now with the M9A3 on the market, I have my suppressed 9mm. Overall, I'm very happy with the handgun. Let's also show you one other thing. And I'm one of those guys that thinks brown is the new black. And I like the fact that it's flat dark earth. I know some of you guys that follow me on Instagram have complained about the gun not being offered in black, at least not yet. Honestly, don't care. I kind of like the flat dark earth, as I said. Go ahead and put my thread protector back on here. And let me show you what's nice about these sights. Nice and large, right angle, so if I need to do a manipulation, one-handed manipulation, I can run the slide very easily on the gun. It locks onto clothing nicely. I don't even have to try. So it's nice, but not so big that it's cumbersome, although I will say with the Rev 9 can, they're not suppressor height, they're not going to clear the suppressor, but I have no problem acquiring the sight picture and putting rounds on target. As a matter of fact, let me grab some more Hush ammunition from Freedom Munitions and load it up, and I'll show you that I'm capable of hitting plates quite a ways away, even though I can't technically see over the suppressor with the sights. So that steel plate's about 25 yards downrange, and I'm shooting even though I can't technically see over the suppressor with the M9A3's sights. Works just fine. Let's take a look at the packaging that the M9A3 ships with. It's actually somewhat unique, and I really kind of like it. It comes in this handy little brown flat dark earth box that kind of resembles a military ammo can. It is made out of plastic. Inside, a little latch here you open. Can be locked, although I don't think it's airline safe, or approved, I should say. Inside, you'll find the pistol, two magazines. There is a magazine in the gun, so you have two extra magazines for a total of three. Over here, you'll have the Hogue grip. It's a wraparound grip, textured, but it's also branded with the Beretta logo. And inside of that, you'll have your Beretta branded lock. Now, since I'll probably never use the Hogue grip, that pouch works nicely for my Revolution 9 Griffin armament suppressor. Closes up, locks away. So I actually get a can in there, right? Pretty cool. So I got my suppressor, my pistol, which sets in there vertically, the extra magazines, and you also find the documentation for the gun. You'll have your warranty card, an M9A3 sticker to put on something like your gun boxes or something, and then a manual. The manual's really nice. It's a color printed manual. Inside you'll find everything that you need to maintain the pistol, to service it, all that good stuff. The whole package is going to set you back $1,099. It's not inexpensive. I can already hear the cries on the internet, it's too expensive. I wish it was 500 bucks. Imagine how many Beretta would sell for a dollar. Yeah, it's a pricey handgun. But if you're a Beretta collector, if you're a fan of the M9 pistol like I am, it's a worthwhile addition to your collection. It's a beautiful handgun, shoots really well, and honestly, it's the most ergonomic of the M9s that I've found so far. Great shooting pistol. I love the fact that I can suppress it, all that good stuff. So I was willing to pay that amount of money to get my hands on one of the early ones. Also, they are shipping. My local gun shop next to us actually got a couple of them in. So they're actually showing up on shelves and you can get them. Once all the excitement kind of peters out, you can imagine the price will probably drop as they usually do. Prices tend to go down, not up. In that case, you'll probably find them for sale right around $900 or so. So if you wanna save a few bucks, wait a little while, pick one up. These are full production handguns and that's the whole point of the gun. It has to be a production handgun for the U.S. military to consider it in the new up-and-coming military handgun trials. If you guys have any questions, you can always ask those questions on our Facebook page. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/militaryarms. Also, if you'd like to support the Military Arms channel, please swing by and shop at coppercustom.com. And you can find all sorts of great products at great prices. And again, that's the best way to support the channel. And if you haven't already, please check out full30.com. That's full30.com. We've taken all the web's best content creators in the gun space and brought them under one roof. And that roof is the full30.com roof. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll talk to you guys soon. Thank you.